So as you got closer to getting out, man, and you felt like, you know, you had to make a life change, what were some of the things you did, man, or what did, you know, how'd you prepare yourself?
Well, that's a good question, Big Herc. So what happened even before, like I had 10 years even before I got close to getting out, like, you know, at
So you
Mill
gave
Creek.
back time before
Yeah,
that, though.
yeah. But you know, good time because I quit. Because
Okay.
what's funny about the California penal system, once you break a dude off like on A yard, like you break him off properly, right? Then you go to the shoe for 90 days or 6 months or whatever. They don't put you back on A yard, they put you on B yard. But word travels, oh, that's that dude does that Fing Fong stuff. So you ain't got a problem no more. No, as long as you're at that prison, they know, like this dude, they call me the monk because all I did was read. And I ain't gonna lie to you, I used to walk around the yard doing my collars and stuff. I just stayed to myself because I didn't watch TV. I didn't want to hear your stories. I just was like, how do I make myself a better person? So I took up meat cutting and that type of stuff. They had a computer programming course in Mule Creek to this white dude start hacking outside of the network. Making money.
Oh, he was a
he's a lifer though. What the hell?
You got some smart people in
you
there
got
though.
Some smart
dude,
people.
People
dude.
That just man
just getting it in.
They get a computer, they make some shit happen.
Yeah. And so then they shut that program down. So then when I got transferred, Big Herc was I went to this program called pre-release because I, you know, like, and I'm not trying to be funny, but a lot of dudes in prison can't read or write. I think that's why a lot of dudes
no,
do
you're
crime.
Right. You're right.
Because they don't have other outlets. Whereas guys like me and you, you know, we've been to school, we know how to read and write, do math.
Plus, it's intimidating that you are able to do that and they can't. So they feel threatened by you.
Right.
Yes.
So I got in this program called pre-release, and I was the assistant to, you know how they bring a civilian in to teach them math and life skills. So I would be grading their papers and stuff. And this is what the dude told me, man. I'll never forget him. He's like, you got all this time in prison. And he did a mathematical quotation on the wall, like how much cocaine I had, how much I sold, the real estate I did, all this stuff. And then what they're paying me now, like you said today, 15 cents a day. Look what you're making now. So all that money you made, you paid legal fees, did all that. Look at this what you, he said, if you just had a job at McDonald's for 10 years, you go to McDonald's University, you become the French fry dude and the hamburger dude than the supervisor and the manager. You make way more money than being a drug dealer that's locked up in prison. So then that's when I said to myself, man, I'm gonna change my life. So I'm in the pre-release, I'm an assistant in the pre-release class for these guys getting out and hurt. I see dudes getting out, they coming back a month later, violations on drugs, stupid shit. And I'm like, what the fuck, bro? You don't like your freedom? Are you institutionalized? No, you get to see, because I got 10 years.
You seen
so
it.
So you see a dude get out, maybe it's a year later. But they just keep coming back. And I said, what's the common denominator? I'm just going to keep reading books. So I took a theology course. I was just taking all kind of classes. You know, I'm in there with the pre-release. I got all kind of books, English, just literature. I just was reading a lot, man, to answer your question. I was just reading a lot and watching TV.
Getting your mind right.
Getting my mind right. And then I... Honestly, Big Herc, I used to visualize myself, and people used to laugh at me. I used to just visualize myself, man, being a businessman when I got out. I didn't know what kind of business I was going to do, but I saw myself with a suit and a tie, driving a nice car, having a hot girl, having a nice house. I just kept thinking about that every day. I don't know why. I just did. Yeah.
So when you got out, man, what was one of the first things you did to kind of get yourself acclimated back into society?
Here's an interesting story. So when I was at Mule Creek, I met some of Dr. Dre's bodyguards. They was in there for life. Like, a lot of people don't know, some of these rappers ain't playing. Like, yeah, maybe they start out as a studio gangster, but when you got that kind of money and you portraying the gangster rap, gangsters come in. Oh, you want to be a gangster?
Real gangster.
This is what's happening. Clean some of this money up or whatever. I don't know their business. But I met two of his bodyguards was in there for life because they smoked some fools, man. Like, stuff be happening in this rap game.
You don't even hear
people
about.
People don't know about. And so they was like, oh, you a cool dude. And I did some bodyguard stuff when I was in the military. And so then we did it. We called Dr. Dre. He offered me a job. So check this out. I'm from up north. So I'm at Mule Creek, right, which is up north. I go down to Avenal, which is kind of central. I parole from Chino so that I can get a job with Dr. Dre. I went to downtown L.A., with my blues on, and my fucking my prison backpack thing, right? Yeah. My prison bag, and I had an interview with Dr. Dre the next day.
Oh wow, from prison.
From prison because
this network
bodyguards.
Yeah,
networking. They like, oh man, you cool dude. No, they showing me pictures and everything, because a lot of dudes be bullshitting in prison. They show me pictures with Dr. Dre partying, call him, talk to him on the phone. Yeah, dude. So when you get out, come see me. So I get down there in downtown L.A. and you got to call your parole officer. So I call my parole officer. Hey, I just got out and everything. I just letting you know I'm down here in L.A. I got a job interview. He said, let me tell you something, fool. You got a parole where you was convicted from. And I say, dude, I shot some dudes up there. I ain't got nobody. My wife left me. I don't care if you ain't on this bus. I'm violating you. Yeah, so I had to get on the Greyhound bus with my prison stuff, dude. You know how long it takes to get from L.A. to fucking...
Man, on a Greyhound? Yeah. Oh, yeah.
When I got there, the parole office was closed. But I'm banging on the door and everything. This Mexican parole officer, man, we're closed. I said, man, I was supposed to report. And he said, what's your name? I gave my name. He said, oh, there's a warrant for your arrest. I said, I just got off the bus. Here's my ticket. And so I'm answering your question. Bro, they did. When I was in prison, they said, oh, when you get on parole, they give you these vouchers for a hotel. They give you vouchers for food. They give you vouchers for clothes. You know what my parole officer said? I ain't got shit for you. Get the fuck out of my office. And I said, bro, pre-release says you got a voucher for a hotel. You get the food and the clothes. He said, if you don't get out of my fucking office, I'm going to violate you. You better tell me where you're staying at. And I had to go stay at the homeless shelter. That's how I got out of prison. The homeless shelter, man.
And they talking about they helping people.
Nah, man, ain't no fucking help, man. I mean, excuse me, ain't no stinking help, man. You know, so what happened was I was working construction, day labor. You know those day labor jobs?
So then I messed the Dr. Dre interview up.
I'm done, man, because I can't even be in L.A. County because you got to, when you go to the state, you got to parole back to wherever you got your offense, right? Even though there's people looking for me, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
I just shot people. They got homies, right? I ain't from here. So I'm doing day labor, right? So my homie, like, he was out before me. He's from CSUN. I was like, man, I'm tired of this day labor shit, and I ain't built for it. He's like, oh, man, old boy's doing computers. Another dude we was in prison with. And I was like, okay, man, make the introduction. So he's like, hey, man, this is dude. You know, oh, yeah, I remember you from San Quentin. You do that Fing Fong stuff. Yeah. I was like, yeah, I want to learn computers. He's like, dude, you just got out of prison. And this dude laced me hurt. He said, you just got out of prison. All you got to do is go to community college. They'll give you a Pell Grant. The pays to get used books, man, and then you just budget your money, man. Take some computer courses, and that's what I did.
Wow.
Yeah.
So then you got into the whole computer programming thing, and
well, what happened was when I was working on campus, I told my professor, man, I was like, man, I'm homeless. I'm trying to do the right thing. I'm trying to make it. You know, I made some mistakes, but I need some help. So he got me a job on the college, just helping students, like, you know, logging into computers and check your email.
Classroom assistant.
Yeah, like that. And so now I'm making a little bit of money. Got my Pell Grant. You know, I get to stay in a hotel, you know what I'm saying? Just life was just moving because I stayed focused. Like, you know, and I have dudes knew me. It was like, hey, OG, you just got out, man. Hey, man, here's 2 ounces in the gun. I was like, hey, homie, if you ever offer that to me again, I'm going to rip your head off. Why are you mad? Because I ain't doing that. And this other dude going to tell me, oh, you prison scared. What's that word they say when you just got out of prison? You prison showers. It's a word meaning you're afraid to go back to prison.
Like you ain't about the business no more.
I said, you damn right, because I ain't built for that.
Yeah.
You know, child time, shower time.
Man, don't, that's nightmare. Lock it down.
Come on, man. Lights out, lights on.
Yeah, I still have nightmares about that.
Me too, dude.
Yeah, it's sad, man, because like you said, you know, if you don't have the resolve to get out and have that, like how you said you got out and didn't have nowhere to go. I remember I got out and, dude, I didn't have no job or nothing, but in my mind, I said, I'm never going to work for somebody. So I'm like, how am I going to make it happen? So, you know, I set up these little moves and I just kept that positive attitude. But like you said, I seen dudes in there and after they done 20, you can see them like going to the career services.
Yeah.
And you can see like they ain't going to last.
Right.
They're not cut. Right. They not mentally prepared to be free.
Yep.
Because the whole time they're in prison, they watch TV, play cards.
See.
They didn't prepare themselves.
Yeah.
And so like you said, by you having that, and not being, because easy, the homie gonna break you off a car, give you a sack, you go do this, you know, and it's like, dude, it takes a lot of discipline.
Yeah.
And like you said, the parade, man, you're on your own.
Yeah.
You're on your own. We don't have nothing for you. Get your ass back before I violate you.
Yeah. And then I had high risk parole because of the guns and the drugs and the shooting.
So they randomly just pull up on you.
No, dude, I got a job, man. Dude gonna show up with his parole badge and the gun's on his damn holster. Yeah, is OG still back here? They go, everybody's like, whoa. I'm like, dude, what are you doing? I can do whatever I want. I'm a parole officer. You parolee. You understand? I hated that dude.
I know how they be.
I hated that dude. Yeah, I'm like, dude. He said, you know what? You can play this game with everybody else. I know you're waiting to sell drugs again and take advantage of single moms. I know the game you're playing. I was like, dude, I'm done with it. Hey, I'm going to tell you something. I ain't built for being locked up like that. Yeah. Like, I didn't know I had claustrophobia. You know what claustrophobia is?
Oh, yeah.
I didn't know that until they locked me up in the 6x8
and you can touch the walls.
Yeah,
you can
touch the walls.
You can touch the walls. And I remember because you lay down in bed, yeah, and you, like your head is hitting the thing, and your feet is touching this. So you roll over,
Yeah.
You know, you can almost roll off the bunk.
Right, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, man. It, people think it's a joke. I tell, man, I'm a big dude like you, so I'm laying halfway off the bunk. My back is wide as the bed.
Yeah. And then it's like they don't open the door till they're ready, man. And then when you go to the shoe, ain't no lights. You just got
AC blowing, one little blanket. If you know,
if you don't have mental resolve, you'll go crazy.
Yeah,
no, because you're just in there by yourself.
I've heard of people in there just they get so crazy they start rubbing shit on themselves.
Oh yeah, I've heard about that.
Yeah, dude, just get in there. You go in there, dude, got shit all over himself. You like the whole cell's the shit.
Yeah.
Shit on the wall.
The
guards look like ooh.
Yeah,
you know what I mean? Like dudes, like they fly the train through there. Dude like, got shit on. He's
right.
Like, talking to himself.
Sometimes they sling it at the guards too when they go to go in the trade.
Yep.
They'll throw shit on them.
Throw a shit bomb.
Yeah.
Horrible, bro. People think I'm telling you. I'll be trying to tell them this. A lot of these dudes be talking like they was up in there doing, dude, shut that shit up. That's some bullshit.
Yeah.
You know, and like you said, you're keeping it real, man. It ain't no game, man.
Nah, man. And then what's funny, Big Herc, like even though I got the job on the campus, you know what I mean? And let's just be real. Like if you paying for a hotel every day, man, like some days it's $60, some days $80, but then a special event comes in, it's $200. So I'm like, I didn't want to go to the homeless shelter, so I was like, I gotta start stacking my chips. So I moved into what's called a boarding house. You know, you got dudes on parole, you got junkies there, you got people on Section 8, you got recovering addicts. So I'm in there, man, and you share the kitchen and the bathroom, right? Dude, you're putting your food in a fucking refrigerator.
Oh, yeah,
people's taking your food, dude. Yeah. You go to use the bathroom, you got a junkie, a dude, OD, blood squirting all out. You're like, Jesus Christ, you got rats and roaches running through there. So I was like, you know what, man? I had already did a semester in school, so then I was just reading the paper just because, I'm going to be honest with you, man, they didn't pay me a lot because they knew I was a felon. This is what they told me. You're a felon student. You're not getting the proper rate. I'm like, wow. I tried so hard to do good, man.
Yeah.
And everybody's just against me. So I was looking in the papers back when they had the paper, Big Herc. And then I was like, they had a job in Silicon Valley, right? Oh, building computers for internet companies, right? So this is what my homie told me. This dude was a cool dude, German dude. He said, look here, man. If you can build a computer, you can build a server. It's just a bigger computer. He said, you got to think forward. Nobody's going to give you a chance. You got to sell yourself. So I went to the interview. They said, hey, how many servers you built? I said, this is what I said, Big Herc. I said, 1 or 1,000, I don't know. That's all I'm saying. This is all I'm saying.
Why did I hear? I can't remember. I did so many.
It's all the same, right? And I said, we can get started right now.
You know, give me the job.
Yeah. They gave me the job, man.
Oh, shit.
They gave me the job, dude. I never looked back, dude. Yeah. I was still in the halfway house, still on parole.
Wow.
And this was funny, guys. I used to go to work because I had high water pants and homeless shelter and shit, you know, two tight shirts. And my boss is like, hey, you're a good worker, man. Like, I'm going to promote you to supervisor. I'm like, oh, great. He said, but yeah, you gotta get a car because we see you coming from the bus. You can't be a supervisor. You gotta dress different. So I bought a cool little car. But it's a boarding house. Oh, you got fellas there, dude.
Yeah.
So I would have my car around the corner.
Yeah, so they don't nobody know. Yeah.
I would have my car around the corner, and I have my cool clothes in the car. So now I act like I'm going to the bus like normal, you know, with my lunch sack. And then I see everybody dipping, doing anything, and I go sneak in my car, you know, way down the street.
Yeah, way down the street.
And then when I get into the office, I go in the bathroom and change, kind of like Superman. And I did that for like 2 years, bro.
Until
I got off parole. Because one time I slipped up. I worked late and I didn't feel like doing the whole change of clothes. And I pulled in and I heard some parolees like, oh man, that square dude living up here. We should jack him.
Oh.
And then the one dude goes, I don't know, that dude's kind of big and crazy looking. Like, I don't think he's going to go for it. And that's when I knew I had to go, right?
Yeah. It's crazy you said that because when I was at the halfway house, I used to park my car way around the corner too, and I would walk, and I'm like hoping nobody would get my car towed. And I remember I was talking with somebody, and I'm like, you know, I got a book I published, and the next day they call me in. Hey, we heard that you publishing books. We want a cut of that. So you're on lockdown until you tell us. I'm like, wait, who? I'm like, goddamn, somebody done already told on me about me doing the books, and you know, they want a cut of everything.
I know, right.
Restitute, you know, for payment.
Yeah.
So, these dudes, I mean, it's so, people to my criminals, these dudes, a lot of them you can't trust them.
I know, bro.
And like you said, they would look at you and they kind of think, oh, he kind of big, but he's square, but so we don't know if it's a good idea.
Right.
So, I can feel you, man. I concur with everything you're saying, man.
But like you used to say in your videos, man, because me and my dude be watching your videos like every day. He was like, don't judge a book by its cover. Because like one thing I learned from being in the pen, whatever a prisoner would do, I'd do the opposite. So if a dude, no offense to anybody, if a dude's sagging with overdressed shirt or whatever, unkept, man, I'm going to be dressing tight, you know what I mean? If a dude's bent over looking at his shoes, I'm going to stand up, look a dude in his eye, you know what I mean? I'm going to be anti-prison. So when, because I've met some females and I slipped up. I'm going to be honest with you. I slipped up. I try to be a good dude. Hey, you know, let's have a baby and get married. You know, I really care about you. There's something I got to tell you. Oh, what's that, baby kids? You're a big teddy bear. You're the best man I ever met. I've been to prison. I shot people and I sold. Oh, dear God. Dear Lord. No way. And I show my paperwork. Oh, God. Help me, Lord. Oh. And then they leave me, man.
Hey, man.
They leave me hurt.
When I met my wife, I didn't tell her. She, like, kind of, like, we met, and then her friends Googled me. Oh, my God. We got to meet. That guy, oh, my God, that black guy, he's been in porn. He's a bank robber. Oh. He did this. And she's like, oh. And then she asked me. I said, look, I did a lot of things. I robbed banks. I used to do porn. I've been to prison. I've been to juvenile hall, you know, but this is what it is. I mean, you know, I'm going to be honest with you. And she's like, okay, well, you're not, you know, and get past. But like you said, I've had before that when I was trying to be honest and pew.
Yeah, they're gone.
You know, because a lot of people, they, oh, my God, that guy, right. You don't tell him what he'll do. What do you know?
Yeah. And it's like you said, man, a lot of people aren't as compassionate. I'm going to be honest with you, man. I think that some people, when they're incarcerated, like my first year in prison, Big Hurt, when I go to the review board, I learned everything I needed to know my first year.
Yeah.
I told the warden, like, dude, I'm so reformed. I'm going to Alcohol Anonymous, Narcotics Anonymous.
Yeah.
I'm religious. You know, I love everybody.
Yeah.
You can let me out. He go, well, unfortunately, you got 9 more guards. No, but I learned. I'm rehabilitated.
Hey, man, it's crazy because, like you said, once you realize, like, you don't want to beat her, like, oh, man, I got another, because in Fed, they count months. I got another 90-something months and shit. I'm like,
man,
you start counting the months.
Yeah.
120 months is what they gave me.
Whoa.
You're like, God damn. And like you said, those killers who be talking on yard, I heard a dude one time, he said, Big Hurt, man, I just want to get out, man.
Yeah.
He's like, dude, I hate this, man. I want to, man, is there anything, you think you can find something over there to get me out? I'm like, looking at that dude like, dude, these are dudes who are cold gangsters.
Oh, I know
but
what you mean.
You say you get one, you do the crime breaking down. Ain't nobody in there trying to beat her for real.
Nah.
I don't care how tough.
Yeah, bro.
Wife done left him. Kids don't talk to him.
Yeah.
You know, grandma done passed. Mom done passed. Dude, it's horrible.
Yeah, it's crazy, man.
It's horrible, man. But, yeah, man, it's crazy, man. You give me flashbacks when you think about some of the stuff, like you said, man. It's like real talk. So now, you know, what are you doing now, man?
No, I'm just doing, like, network consulting, you know. Me and my homie, man, we just, like, take these short-term contracts. It's just more efficient.
Okay.
Because even still, some now they're getting really heavy on these background checks. Like, before they would do, like, 3 year or 5 or 7 or 10. I can pass those. When they do life. And so now a lot of these, with the cybersecurity and the Russians and stuff, nothing against the Russians, but, you know,
they're
Russians
everything.
Hacked the election and the Chinese, right? So they're just doing, like, they're checking everything. So now when they run the background, even I'm the best dude for the job, they do a life scan. Oh, shit.
Trying to explain that is like.
No, you can't. When a person sees your rap sheet, bro, you're not a human anymore. You're just like, oh, God, they're God, you're Jesus. Because one time I got this, look, it was just 50 candidates for a network engineering job for a big company. I was the number one candidate. And it was this hot Filipino receptionist lady. She was on my job, right? Oh, you're so manly. We need men like you around here. I'm going to get your paperwork started. And then my background check came through. She came in with 2 big white dude security dudes. She stood outside here right there.
Oh.
Sir, can you leave? I said, what's going on? We don't hire people like you here. I said, but just before you was rubbing on my muscles and stuff, right? So
oh,
I just like,
shit.
You know, I believe that people can be rehabilitated, but I think society as a whole, seriously, a lot of people don't forgive you for your past.
Nah,
I
still hold that.
Man.
I remember I was trying to get my Series 7. I had got a Series 21, and when they went to get Series 7, they came back, Mr. Timmons, we got to let you go. We can't let you get a Series 7 with that type of background record, blah, 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 blah. So, you know, you got to, you know, once you have that, you got to find ways around it.
Right.
Because, like, there will be certain doors closed, but at the same time, doors will open. So I looked at that like, okay, well then let me do something else, you know. Mm-hmm. But that was always my thing to be. I want to be a, you know, a stockbroker. I watch Wall Street.
Yeah.
I want to be Gordon Gekko.
Yeah.
You know, Michael Milken. Get that
boiler
paper.
Room. You
know what I mean? Yeah. You know, I want to get that paper, man. So I studied for that. But you know, I had to find a different career choice. But man, you really made it happen, man. And for what you went through, bro. I mean, God, man, that's a hell of a story, man. And not many people bounce back, dude. I drive down the street all the time, and I see people. I mean, like, dude, like, you wonder what happened with their life. Mm-hmm. And you, like you said, some of them dudes, you done been, they've been to the same places we've been through and didn't bounce back.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So, to hear your story and to hear what you're doing now, like when I met you in Monterey, you're I mean, you're like, what's up, man? What's up? I mean, here we go.
I see you from YouTube. Yeah,
between us, we got over, you know, 20 years of jail time, but we're out here mingling with people that have no idea.
Right.
You know, and like you said, people look at you, the square, people look at me, oh, this guy's square. And don't get the game twisted.
Right.
You know
right,
what I mean?
Right.
I'm square, I'm nice, but don't touch me.
Hey, but I first saw you in Monterey, you was walking around, dude, you was dressed nice, dude. You had the polo shirt on with your hat, sharp shoes on, just watch balling. I thought, this is a professional football player. This dude's swole, man. And then you stop by the, not the Lamborghini, but the new Mercedes with the wings coming out.
Yeah.
And that's when I was like, hey, man, you Big Herc from YouTube. He's like, yeah, man, I'm doing my vlog right now. What's up, Big Herc? I was like, yeah, I'm just working here, man. I want to get with you, man. Yeah. You know, but you didn't know I had been to prison. I just, you know.
Hey, man, it's a beautiful thing, man, because you put that energy out and you reach other people. And here you are sharing your story. That's going to affect millions of people.
Yeah.
Millions of people watch our show, man. So kids, people who have been through the system, they can listen to what you had to share, and even ex-military guys. And dude, that's a hell of a comeback.
Yeah.
You know, and I commend you on that, man. I mean, if you could share anything with the people viewing this interview, what would you want to tell them as far as, you know, advice or a younger version of you?
Well, this one I would tell them, Big Herc, you may disagree, but we all make mistakes, man. But once you make a mistake, don't keep making them, man. Like, once you make a mistake, just sit back, take some chill time out and be like, okay, I messed up. How can I correct it? Because if you keep making mistakes, you're just going down a hole, man. And once you get to that hole, some people go to prison, don't get out.
Yeah. I mean, you know, that situation could turn into a murder.
Yeah.
They could turn, you know, you've seen a hack turn into a murder,
you
man.
Defending yourself, you're defending yourself, and the warden's like, well, you took a man's life, so you're going to do his time. Yeah. Wow, really?
Yeah, and this dude, he's the one who had the knife initially.
Yeah, he's trying to go up in my anus.
Yeah. So what do you expect me to do? You know what
right
I mean?
Write a 602, Big Herc.
Yeah. Hey, help me.
Yeah, type
he's
it
taking
out.
My butthole. Help me. Butthole relief. Please help me. Emergency. Cell 5555. Yeah. Help me. You know, in the meantime, this motherfucker.
Right.
No, I'm going to choke his ass out.
Right, yeah.
You know, or bust his head.
Yeah.
You know, so it's not a joke, man. But like you said, people, they sit here and they like, well, you're defending yourself. Well, you didn't have to kill. Well, dude, he was going to try to kill me. So what's the difference?
Right.
So, man, it's serious talk, man. But, dude, I never knew, you know, your story. So getting your story today, man, I think a lot of people are going to watch this channel and see your interview and really be touched, man. And it's going to open up the eyes to a lot of people. And I told a lot of, just like a lot of these square kids, and going back to what's going on now with the protests, these dudes getting picked up and, you know, firebombing police cars. You know, so many people were computer people, nerds, lawyers. That lawyers got picked up. Passing out bombs. Dude, you go to the feds?
Oh, yeah.
They ain't come for that.
No.
Y'all better wake up, man.
Yeah, man.
You better wake up. We trying to give you a heads up, man.
Yeah.
So, OG Silverback right here kicking some game, man. Big Herc, fresh out. Subscribe and support, man.